Interesting. Okay, they call me Pradeep Surisetti. So I work for Red Hat Performance Engineering. I joined around 7 months before. I work closely with our performance team and our KVM development team. Karen, Kevin, Paul, Paulo, and Stefan. I feel privileged for that. Okay. I'll be covering three things today. What is the motivation for us to do this work? And second thing, what is the problem we are trying to solve? And third, I have some of the performance results. A lot of performance results. I don't think we'll be able to go through all of them. We'll be sharing that. And this is one of the recent performance brief which was released. It's, I think, 2-3 days before which this was released. So before jumping to, I'll just spend some time on the KVM IO basics. It's just for a couple of minutes. So this is our typical architecture. This is my KVM guest. This is my KVM guest, and each KVM guest CPUs has dedicated VCUP threads, which talks to KVM kernel module. So which runs my guest code, using so my guest code is being run by VCUP, which is being talked to, which is talking to KVM module, and also I have a separate IO thread. There is a separate IO thread using select loop, which will handle all the events. So this is what precisely it looks our IO kernel IO KVM IO architecture. So before moving, it'll be good to know what was happening earlier to appreciate it. What is there today. So back then for full virtualization. So full virtualization. I'll spend a couple of minutes here. So with full virtualization, unmodified guest. So we were running unmodified guest on KVM with IDE, SATA, SCSI. That means, as we know, so we had a lot of issues with this, performance issues. As we had to do put a trap and emulation for each and every operation, so we had to do this trap and emulation. It's like compared to today, with this, probably we had around 30 to 40% of the performance drop back then. So then slowly we moved on, and this is para virtualization. With this, whatever BLK, whatever SCSI, so later many come. And we have effective guest and host communication with this. And the problem we solved is using whatever ring buffer. So we have a ring buffer. We'll be collecting all the queues and we'll be merging all of them and submitting, whether it is read or write and random read, all of them. So we merge requests and send it. So with this, yeah, we improved the performance compared to IDE. And still we had a couple of issues So with the AO case, we'll have to take global mutex, which I'll be talking. So another one later after these two. So third one is PCI pass through. So for example, SRAOV or so PCI pass through. It performance wise it's really cool, but it has got its own limitation. Like I have limited performance PCI devices, and little expensive as well. And hard for live migration. So it has got its own limitations. So some people tend to use it, and mostly people tend to use whatever. Now, again, back to the old problem. As I was talking about this full virtualization and para virtualization here, for full virtualization trap and emulation. And para virtualization, it is modified guest, which has where I have whatever drivers installed. Yeah. So with whatever, as I was mentioning, we have this V-ring buffer here. So my whatever device, it will be so my each and every device will have a separate word queue. Okay. This is I'm talking before data plane. So before data plane coming into picture, I'm talking about that. So each device has a separate word queue. And all of these requests are there in V-ring. Once we submit this request, then it will send a kick. So it will kick your queue. Hey boss, I have so many requests. You go ahead and submit your device. So I have the shucks. I'm new to this. Okay. So with this kick, now we can go ahead and submit it. Other one, so as I was talking about this, we are back to, so after PCI still we have this, so we are back to the problem because of the limited PCI devices and data plane. So data plane today, this is what we have got. It's tried to solve most of the problems, okay, the problems what we spoke already. And we are here today, and with there is no big Humo lock. We never know, probably Stefan and Kevin, they might come up with something else later. For now, this is what we have. My experiment mostly I covered with whatever BLK, because in OpenStack that's being used. So I haven't covered data plane performance results, which I'll be reporting down the line. And this is the storage configuration, so which I try to cover most of them. So this is my storage and my host to VM. I try to attach LVM or else file-based or block-based. Both of them are covered, so which I'll be covered or talking about it. Okay, the problem. So this is the problem what we had. So when initially, so when I started, I joined Red Hat, so this was the mandate. So this was the mandate given to me. Like, you know, OpenStack, libvirt, AIO module, so modes for disk devices. There are two modes, whether it's like native and threads. So we have got it. Then native, as you know, native is asynchronous. It submits, it does IOs as a submit system calls. That means from VM, I'll be submitting my request using IO symbols. So once this, since it is asynchronous, once this read or write is done, then again, it will be notified, QMU will be notified with event FDs. So this is how it has been going on. And the synchronous is IO is equal to threads. It is done with our regular system called period 64 and period 64, like period pwrite. The problem is, okay, theoretically, so when we ask someone, so which one should perform better, whether it is asynchronous or synchronous? Generally, so it's asynchronous, right? So that's how it has been the case. And in OpenStack, this is the default choice. So AIO is equal to threads is default choice, which is synchronous. So this is based on the previous performance results. So we just wanted to figure out, okay, this is the reference for that, the reference link. We just wanted to figure out with the latest QMU, so which we had in RHEL 7.2. I don't recall the version. So we just wanted to figure out with the different combinations and see what is the problem and is there something we can do to improve. Just one of the example is when I attach my disk is either with the KVM or the plain KVM or with OpenStack. So as I was telling, IO is equal to native. So I try to attach from the same storage, I try to attach two devices, one with native and one with threads. So from the same storage, it's mounted under XFSR, different file systems. Okay, another problem with the threads and native was, so as you see here, initially, when I started this again, these multiple experiments with native, so this is the performance. So this is the CPU says of while using AIO is equal to native. When I'm submitting multiple requests from around 16 VMs concurrently, if I try to submit, so this is how it is. CPU says it's not much. Then with threads, if you compare to native, this is slightly higher side of it. It's higher side of, so compared to native, it's CPU usage is more. So if we can improve native performance, yeah, then we can save enough CPU, then probably we can run some more VMs on that concurrent. So concurrently, we should be able to submit IOs and we can run some more VMs. Okay, so after all this, so we thought of listing down which are all experiments we should be covering. So first one, hardware, SSD and HDD. Yeah, mostly, this is what, and then LVM, EXT4, or XFS, with NFS and EXT4 XFS. So I thought I covered most of them. Then QKO2, so this QKO2 with FELAC. So this FELAC is, while creating your image, so there is an options, right? With QMU image, while creating the image, you have this pre-allocated option, whether it is pre-allocated none, pre-allocated metadata, pre-allocation is equal to FELAC, pre-allocation full. So I try to use this FELAC. And other one is QKO2 with FELACate. Plain QKO2 create it, and FELACate, it's just a Linux command. So with that, pre-allocate your VM. This is more of a pre-allocation, but okay, these also being used. in some of the enterprise or community of OpenStack. The reason behind that is, see, some people, okay, this QR2 with Fallock, it is not supported with backing file. So typically when you create a backing file, and so you'll be keep creating VM thread, having your backing file. So this Fallock, it's not being supported at this moment. So then people use this QR2 with Fallocate. So at this, so as of today, and then RAW pre-allocated. So these are the experiments. And jobs, sequential read, sequential write, random read, random write, random read write, and block sizes, 4, 16, 256, number of VM, single VM and 16 VM. So 16 VM, when I say 16 VM, concurrently writing it, concurrently reading it. So that day is how it is. I thought, okay, I'm so good here, I covered most of them. Then yesterday while speaking to Kevin, here I missed GlusterFS and Ceph, so which I haven't covered. Yeah, down the line I have plans to cover. And Kevin was telling, boss, still missing a couple of things. I was like, man, okay, I'll cover some more. After covering this many, Kevin said, yeah, we'll cover some more. Okay. Yeah, this is the test environment I had got. So one machine, so the 256 RAM and host. I had one SSD and one HDD device. So as I was covering both SSD and HDDs, so I have both of them. So I'm slightly digressing. So for now, like, which are all the tools we try to use it while running these benchmarks? One is this PBench. So recently it has been open source by Performance Team. I like this. So pretty much. So what it does is, it provides easy access for benchmarking and performance tools. So all the debugging tools, whichever you have got, all of them are tightly coupled with PBench. And also you should be able to run your benchmarks with PBench, so PBench like FIO and NetPerf, or what most of the performance tools are integrated. That means this is what it does. Before running my benchmark, it will go and clear all your disk cache, everything, and make sure that you register all the configuration. That means before running the test. And it start this, it's fully automated. It start the benchmark. While benchmark is running, it will capture your debug logs in a frequent intervals, like SAR, S-trace, all of them, block trace, you name it is there. So it captures in a frequent intervals. And then once the job is done, so we have, once the job is done, it will kill all the records, all the tools which are being recorded, all the debugging tools which I was speaking about. And then it will move results to third-party machines where we can get nice graphical view. So I'll show you this graphical view how we get it. So for example, see here, as I was showing earlier, so this is how we get this SAR output. And each CPU, how much of CPU utilization here, and frequency being recorded. It's more. I try to capture only limited graphs, but there are n number of things here. It's like with Iostat, so each disk. So for example, this disk, home, each disk, how much it is being used, and tool visualization. There are many more. So these are how it looks like. So these are how we can run. So just an example one, PBench FIO, this configuration, and targets, like, and you should be able to run concurrently on all of the machines. So this is how I was able to run concurrently on multiple machines. On the same host, I had 16 VMs. From all of them, I was running concurrent reads and sequential reads. You can mention various configuration options. You should be able to run it. And test types, read, random read, block size, everything. And as we know, I used FIO. So this is one of the famous tool for IO benchmarking. So this is what I have. So I was using, like, changing IO engine, IO depth, and IO type. There are multiple options, right? Okay. So this is the again back to the problem. With PBench, so while running this, while running IO, for example, I was running 4K sequential read, random read, all of that. So the performance difference, what we see is as I was mentioning, native and threads. Compared to threads, native performance was almost like 20% lesser than threads. So there's a valid reason for for OpenStack team to use threads as a default option, because we see performance differences initially. Before solving the problem, so there was around 20 to 25% performance degradation was there. But then we went back and checked. So as I was mentioning, PBench captured all the results. So yeah, as you see here, guest 100%. So with IOSTAT, as you see, 100% consistently. That means we keep constantly keep writing to the disk. So on guest 100%. So effectively on host, these are before starting any benchmark. So these we tend to have both on host and guest. We tend to have 100% IOSTAT. So here on guest I have 100%. On guest host I have only 50%. That means on guest I have enough number of requests to submit, but somehow it's not writing back to disk, reading. So it's not, see here as you see 50%. Then we went back and checked run block trace. So we realized that. Okay. So this we covered. So I thought of referring once again. As I was mentioning, these my wearing buffer, which I'll be submitting all the requests. Your whatever device will submit all the requests, and from here we'll send a kick, right? Now, why I had to include this once again here is, the problem which we were speaking on guest we were seeing 100% IOSTAT. So on host we were seeing only 50%, right? So the reason behind that is we had multiple requests in the queue, like word queue, we had multiple requests, but here QEMU was submitting only one request at a time. Imagine for each 4KB request, it's separate IO submit call. As I was mentioning, with native, we submit using IO submit, right? So we submit requests using IO submit. We use IO submit system call. So separate for each 4KB we had to use separate requests. So this is one of the bottleneck for us. And then it's just a few lines of code change. Then so Stefan made this change, like merge all of them and submit at once. This is okay. Again, this is with WhatIO, not with data plane. In with data plane and WhatIO SCSI, we already have this, but with WhatIO BLK we didn't have that. So with read we had this problem, and if we submit all of them at a time, yeah, again 20% of the performance boost, and you are more or less close to the equal to threads, and also in some cases it's better than threads also. So now again we went back to OpenStack team. So this is the patch. What is IO batch submission? So handle more requests in one single IO submit. So one syscall. So we should be able to multiple requests can be submitted through one submit IO submit. That means drastically we are reducing IO submit calls. And this is the patch. We went back to OpenStack team. So we again ran the benchmarks, all of them, and went back to OpenStack. And OpenStack made the default choice as native. With couple of constraints, still, so in some cases OpenStack used IO threads, and some cases IO is good native, and eventually enterprise OpenStack and some of those other management tools. Okay, so this is the performance results I had, like test specification, single VM and multi VM, disk SSD, FS, so I use LVM and image raw as I was telling pre-allocated. So here we had this detail. We have all the details. So in which case, as I was mentioning, I was running 4K, 16K, 16K, 256K, 64K, right? So in which case, which one is performing? There are slightly some changes also there. So still there is a lot to improve. So this as of today. I'll be sharing these results. There are multiple things here. I don't think I'll be able to go through all of them now. Okay, so this is how performance graphs. Can you see this? No? Okay. Mm. Please. There is no way I can improve, I can increase. So, okay, I'll be sharing it. So, here, so this is what, as you see here, so this comparison for every day, so every test for work, so what we have got. Like, this is comparison for random read write. Sorry, this is random read. And with LVM. So, with for first two, with first one is a native with LVM. And second, again, native with the threads with LVM. And third, so there is color coding is there, so we can refer it easily. And EXT4, here, third one, native, again, fourth one, threads. So here, this one, XFS, yeah.
Can I ask you something?
Yeah.
So does it mean that, if I'm reading this right, performance on the bare block device, which is basically just the device mapper device, is the same as with writing into the image into the file system? That's what I'm...
Even worse.
Well, I'm seeing the first three, you know, things, where I'm seeing the read-rand,
correct. Okay, I understand that. So, as you say, LVM should be performing better than EXT4 and XFS because we have VFS layer. So, these are the results I have got. So probably I'll go back and so investigate it.
No,
so, this is what.
Maybe that we are great in file systems and do the great job, so we not even notice us. But I would think so. So
that's
surprising.
They are basically the same.
Yeah,
okay.
More or less. Okay,
yeah.
So. You okay?
So
once you go.
Reallocated images, so the file system should actually not have that much overhead.
Well, it depends how you reallocate them.
Right? Okay.
You use file gate, so then.
No, this is not okay. This is not file gate. So this, as I said, it's LVM, right? This is raw image.
Right.
I pre-allocated with DD, so pre-allocated all of them, not file gate. So I'll talk to that file gate.
You wrote zeros.
I wrote zeros on all of them. Okay, so
sure.
Yeah, thanks, Kevin. So this is what it is, like this is for random read for 4K, you can compare it. So same way 16K, you should be able to, so like here as you see, native is performing better than threads, same way, so this is how it is. No, I'm giving an example here, so with this we can take it, so we can take it further. But okay, in case if someone wants to use pre-allocation, yeah, this is the better way. It's a better way for them. But okay, while talking about the conclusions, so I'll touch upon that. And random read-write. So here, so these are how it is. Native threads. These again with L, so with the raw pre-allocation. And this is sequential read, and sequential read, sequential write, and these with HDD. So as I was mentioning earlier, this was earlier with 16 VM, now with HDD 16 VM. We can go back and check these results. This is with the single VM. Now again back to SSD with single VM. Okay, with QCO2 there are multiple options we had to cover. As I was mentioning with QCO2, plain QCO2 image, and QCO2 with FelaKate, QCO2 with FelaLock. With EXT4, XFS, so there are multiple options here. Yeah, it will be difficult to go through all of them. There is a lot of data here, so probably it will take a lot of time to cover this. So I'll be sharing these slides. Yeah, we can go through that. And SSD, QCO2, same thing with SSD, multi VM, 16 VMs.
Do you see any difference in the between disk and SSD?
What?
Do we see any difference between disk and SSD in the file? So
yeah, SSD.
SSD uses probably the NOC, which obviously probably uses the deadline scheduler. Is the scheduler?
With SSD, so there is a huge performance improvement. So I don't have a comparison now with SSD compared to HDD. But if we.
Well, it's the same. So native is better in both.
run this with NFS. Okay. So this is in OpenStack, which I was mentioning. So here, only native is being changed to for default. Default is equal to default as native. But this is like, as I said, it's not for all, so all formats. And this is the performance brief. Yeah, you can refer it. And conclusion, yeah. So your question. So throughput increases a lot because of IO thread takes fewer CPUs. So fewer, this one. Can I use mouse? Okay. As I was mentioning with threads, with the threads we tend to use more CPUs, more CPU cycles. So if you can increase further native, that'll be even more good. So we'll have to see down the line how it goes. And minimum number of IO submit calls to complete this task. And yeah, so this is the conclusion. Writes to sparsely allocated files are more likely to block than fully pre-allocated files. That means native is preferable if your disk is, if your image is fully pre-allocated. If not, still go ahead with threads. So that's how OpenStack is using. So as you asked, so in OpenStack, if someone wants to use that, someone wants to use pre-allocated, it is the way to go. Yeah. And threads, it's continued to be there with the sparse. We'll have to see how it goes further. Future work. These are the references. Okay. I was working with Andrew and Stefan, so we three of them. You must be doing both of them. So we three used to work in IBM. Again, all moved to Red Hat, and we all worked on this. It's nice. Yeah, that's pretty much. Any questions? Thanks. So yeah, as I said, there are a lot of graphs. So this is being shared. This presentation, yeah, probably you can go through that.
Hello.
Hello.
Good afternoon. Yeah, you can hear.